On March 5th, 2012, a statue outside a church in Mumbai began to weep. Water flowed out from its stores, and the church and its people believed that this holy water was a sign of God. Hundreds of believers flocked to the dripping cross, collecting and consuming this holy water. The next day, Sanal Edamaruku, the president of the Rationalist Association of India, was invited on a talk show in New Delhi to speak about this claim, where he rejected the possibility of this miracle but had no scientific proof to back it. The church then invited him to Mumbai, and upon arriving at the statue and having a closer look, he noticed a nearby washroom and a drainage system that passed underneath the concrete base of the cross. Water from the washroom, which had been blocked in the clogged drainage system, had been transmitted via capillary action into the adjacent walls and the base of the cross, as well as into the wooden cross itself. The water came out through a nail hole and ran down over the statue's feet. What happened next is something Sanal will explain during this episode. Sanal Edamaruku was born in Kerala and is an author and the founder and editor of Rationalist International and is the president of the Indian Rationalist Association. He's authored over 25 books and has traveled extensively across India, debunking godmen, miracles, and superstitions. I speak to him about his learnings and also unpack questions about spiritual gurus, enlightenment, religion, and faith. You're listening to Culture Youth.
Thank you, Sanal, for joining me today.
Nice hearing you.
You know, I'd first like to ask you, what does it mean to be a rationalist?
Well, I mean, it's one of the easiest questions probably and most difficult to answer, because to become a rationalist in India, it means a lot. Because in a society where the majority of the people are succumbing to superstitions, and the mainstream of the whole society is going in a different direction, which is more on caste and religion and superstition, to stand for reason, to defend common sense, is a big task. Back in 1995, I think, one of the major newspapers in India made a survey to understand what's the level of belief in India, or how is faith in India. And at that time, they said 93% of the Indian population are believing in God, believing in kind of faith and religious structures, I mean, altogether, 93%. And I was pretty happy seeing that, because which means 7% of Indian population at that time were non-believers, not committed to non-conformists, not committed to any religion, or they declared themselves absolutely non-religious, which means we have 2% of Christians in India, 1% of Sikhs in India, 1% of Buddhists in India, and less than 1% of Jainis in India. And the atheist population in India is more than the combined population of all these communities. The only thing is that the rationalists and atheists are scattered. They are not like a religion, behaving like a community, but as individuals. It's growing very fast. But it's a very difficult task in India.
You know, I want to go back to the beginnings about your upbringing and what it was like. I read that your father was a well-known author of over 170 books, ranging from religion, philosophy, to miracles. What was it like growing up in this household?
Well, I mean, it looks very colorful when you see it from outside. But, you know, in the beginning of my parents' life, things were not that easy. For example, they came from two different religions. My father was from a Christian family, very traditional, conservative Christian family. And my mother came from a very traditional and conservative Hindu family. They were classmates and fallen in love, and they both were thinking beyond religion. And when they decided to be together before practically settling down, they have been thrown out from the homes. And later, of course, they were staying at my father's ancestral home. But when my mother was pregnant, when she had labor, they were thrown out because she refused, both of them refused, to convert to Christianity as the family wanted. So they, she had to walk. I mean, unexpectedly in the night, they decided that they have to go off or they should convert. So they walked to my mother's home, which was 12 kilometers away. And before they could reach my mother's home, maybe half an hour before that, she delivered a child, and that was me. I mean, on way and under a tree in rain. So that's the kind of beginning I had. But of course, later my father was the editor of one of the biggest newspapers in Kerala. They have been socially aware and socially committed people. So they gave me total freedom. Despite they being atheists, they proposed that I should be exposed to everything, not indoctrinated by anything. And when I am adult, I could decide what I want. And I was not denied any kind of information. I was seeing Bible and Quran and I mean Ramayana, and everything was at our home because we had a huge collection of books. And along with my mother's relatives, I have gone to temples and seen what it is. And along with my father's relatives, I have gone to the church and seen what it is. Of course, I was not influenced by any of that. And when I joined the school, well, they took again a very interesting position. My parents suggested that I don't have any religion now. If I want at all anytime, then I should do it when I'm an adult only. So in the school records, they proposed that I should not have any religion in the column there, which is, there's a column in the schools at that time. It was written nil, no religion and no caste. And the school refused to give me admission, and they had to fight. They had to went to the authorities, and finally I got an admission. I became the first student in our country entering into a school without religion in official records. I mean, it was interesting because I felt, I mean, in a way, privileged to know about everything, no prejudice against anything. And I was growing naturally, and naturally means without any religion, without any communal commitments. And I opted freedom, that's no religion.
You know, that brings me to my next question about religion that is ingrained in people's lives. You know, we are born and raised with rituals being all around us, and we are told that God is watching when we do something bad, and God is there when we want to achieve something good. I want to ask you two things. One is about God, and the other one is about this thing that a lot of people say these days about being spiritual. What is your take on both of these?
I think, you know, the idea of God, as nowadays many people speak, it's a Semitic idea. Because if you take the Indian, for example, the Vedas, there is no specific personal God, a single God creating and controlling and, I mean, looking into every fine details of our, being. It's not there in the Indian concept or in any Oriental concept. It's a Semitic belief. Now everybody has taken the Semitic belief and everybody speaks about a universal God. Fine, that's perfectly okay for me, if whatever people want to believe. But the moment you believe in a God, as I've seen with many other people, you are feeling that you are intimidated, you are controlled, somebody is looking into every little act of you, because there are rules for God. As per Quran, there is a rule. As per Bible, there is a rule. As per most of the Hindu texts, there are rules how we should do and what is good life. And you have your own judgment. It's not possible. So one lives in permanent fear, permanent haunting atmosphere. And that's terrible. I feel that a person growing without religion, growing without fear of God, is a very confident person normally. And unless and until he's intimidated with other things, he would be seeing life realistically without thinking that somebody is watching you all the time. But your conscience, your social commitment, your responsibilities guiding you and taking you forward, that's a big difference. And coming to spirituality, I don't know how this word is confused these days, because spirituality per se meaning connected to spirit, the spiritual world. That's the fundamental of it. Post death, you have a life that is the life of a spirit. And after life, when you die, there is something going out of your body, which is a spirit. That's the fundamental belief. From there comes the spiritual word. But this word is now used by a lot of other people in a different context. For example, personally an atheist, Gorbachev used the term spiritual. He said he's a non-believing spiritual person. Well, I mean, there he tries to say is that there is a certain value which many people think connected to the word spiritual, which is actually an imposed idea. And you don't want to be separated with that. So you, many people try to say that I am spiritual but not religious. But you cannot be, I mean, if you are not religious, I mean, you cannot be spiritual. I mean, the whole idea of spirituality comes from faith, of something that is not existing. You can be said that I'm an ethical person. I have empathy that fulfills what is meant by many people by spiritual. The spiritual word is confusing, and I would not like to use such a word.
So that brings me to speak about Godman and now these charismatic gurus who usually have a high profile status and cult following. Now, we've seen so many of these Godmen, you know, rise up and fall. I want to ask you about how does one become a Godman? And also, do you think that they can be a guru who, like a mentor, who can help you in understanding life better?
Well, to become a guru, it's very simple. Buy a pair of saffron clothes, wear it, grow some beard, and declare that you are a guru. People are waiting for, I mean, such people, and immediately you are a guru. I know that, I mean, some time back, I mean, there was a guru in Delhi who was arrested for running a big chain of a call girl racket. And, I mean, looking into his background, one found that, I mean, he was a guard in some of these, offices in Delhi. And one fine day, he decided that this is not paying properly, and he purchased a pair of saffron clothes and declared himself a guru. And soon, he was rising. Like, he had schools and hospitals, and, I mean, he had institutions and big following. And, I mean, of course, I mean, that's an easy way. There have been many people who simply declare themselves to be holy, and they are fraudsters, most of these people. Who the self-styled Godmen are fraudsters, because they know that this is meaningless. They know that there are vulnerable people. They want to exploit it. And there's an arbitrary assumption of authority that they declare, and they say that they have some power. They have a power to control your mind. They have the power to influence things. They have the power to take you forward, and they are the gateway to the supernatural. I mean, all these kind of claims are there. And since in India, we have a situation that many people are vulnerable to these kind of claims, these people find easy success. I don't want to go into the personal history of all these famous gurus, but that's not my intention also. But I would categorize these gurus as two kinds of people. One set of people who are pure fraudsters, thinking that this is a good profession, and then just buy a pair of saffron clothes and declare themselves gurus. They are the majority, and they are super fraudsters. There could be other people who believe that there is a system of faith which is connected to the Indian tradition of sadhu, and all these kind of things. And there are some orders, and some people come into that. But again, these people try to influence the common folk with an authority which they actually do not have. Nobody has an authority on the minds of other people or the lives of other people. They pretend that they have an authority, and they pretend that they can control things. They pretend that they are powerful than the other people. They pretend that the custodians of morality, and they're the custodians of spirituality, or the custodians of faith. So I would say that they are less fraudsters, but maybe they are really believing that they are in certain order, and they have certain responsibilities. They are the kind of priests of Indian structures. Well, I would not attack them. I would rather tell people not to go for these people, but to decide for yourself. Don't succumb to these gurus. Take the reins of your life in your hand and go forward. Reject these gurus. But then there is a third group of people. They're pure psychopaths. Some people, if they have hallucinations, if they're schizophrenic, they think that they're seeing things and they're experiencing extraordinary things, and they may have wonderful special experiences, and they may see things which others don't see. And the psychopathic people are normally taken as great spiritual masters. And if you see what they speak, there must be a lot of contradictions. Most of these people are very, very vocal. But look at five statements that they have in five different days. You see the simple contradiction in what they say. There is no consistency in what these people speak. Well, they are also taken as spiritual masters in our country. The whole idea that we need masters is wrong. People should be able to decide for themselves. And that's the new culture that we have to build up, that we can take the reign of our life. We can think for ourselves. We don't want somebody else to think for us. We don't want somebody else to control our life. We are capable and we are able, and we should be able to do things by ourselves. That's the new culture we are trying to promote.
You know, that actually brings me to a question about that all of these gurus do have a large following. What does that say about the human mind, and why do we tend to always try to find answers by these kind of images and these kind of godly figures?
Well, in a society where people are in permanent uncertainty, insecurity, there is the general tendency to look for a master who can guide you. I mean, in every society, I would say, which is insecure, we see these kind of people. Look at the best example you can compare also. The most successful, European countries in Scandinavia, the influence of all the spiritual people are absolutely nil. The religion, of course, in some countries, there are still official religions, but the number of people who go to the conventional religions, it has come down. Sweden, Finland, Norway, Denmark, Switzerland, all these countries, the number of people who do not practice any religion, who do not believe in these kind of things, are something like 70-80%. So this has happened because people are not insecure. They are in a position to control their lives in a better way. And in countries where, for example, where religion is going down everywhere in Europe, it's dramatically going down. But in some other parts of the world, religion is not going to be over very soon, because in some other parts of the world, it's growing. In Africa, in Latin America, in many parts of Asia, religion is still growing and getting more and more influence, because people are in a lot of difficulties there. The more social pressures are there, the more insecurities are there, people try to be part of a group with an imaginary expectation that will give them some kind of justification for their life, some kind of meaning for their life, because that's the way they are built up there. In another pattern, where in transforming societies, you see a lot of people who are comfortable, moving to religion. For example, India is a good example. India is a fast-growing economy. We are not a third world anymore. We are a very fast-growing economy. The large number of people who were poor earlier are moving towards the middle class with buying power. This fast transformation, this I have been speaking for last 10, 20 years when that new transformation began. We find a new sect of people who are shifting from the poor to the middle class. There is a tendency amongst them to stick on to spiritual gurus. Why? Because the speed of this transformation is so fast, and suddenly they have buying power, they have new comfort in life, and they feel again insecure. Will the new change remain with us? Will it go away? This was too fast. So therefore, they want a safety belt to hold. So they hold on this imaginary safety belt, which these gurus try to provide. The conventional religions do not do it. See, look at the people who are going to the small temples, for example, in Delhi or in Mumbai. The new gods or the new symbols of spirituality that emerges have more followers. For example, look at any Shiva temple in Mumbai and look at the people who are going to Shirdi Sai Baba's Mandir. So they need new symbols. The traditional religions, they feel that it's not fulfilling their imagination. Most of these prayers are like a telephone call with the you talk to the other side where nobody is responding to the other side. Prayers are simply, there is nobody on the other side. But a guru is a real person who answers your questions, who talk to you. So many people go into that. So this group, these people who are moving from the otherwise socially vulnerable situation to the middle class, they have a tendency to become more vulnerable also.
I want to move away from the godman to another set of things that I think you touched upon this in your last two questions, but astrology, you know, numerology, and they've been there for centuries, and people in India were also very successful, intelligent, believe nowadays a lot in numbers. They believe in changing their names in terms of letters. And you did say that does come out of insecurities, but also the governments and the private sector use astrology for sometimes making decisions. And I feel that can also be a little dangerous. What do you have to say about these occult sciences that have sprung up a lot?
not only corporations, but all times, kingdoms or nations consulted astrologers to decide time for the war, and sometimes got disastrous defeats also. Many of our ancient kings, both the sides followed astrologers. Both the sides consulted astrologers, and one of them anyway got defeated. So astrologers never decided anything. They did not decide anybody's victory. And any kind of astrological prediction, of course, 50% it can be correct. And the most of them make predictions in such a way that which can be interpreted in any way. It's very easy. It's a tricky language most of them use. It could be simply be interpreted in any different way. Ask 5 astrologers on one same thing. They will have 5 different answers. It's such a fake idea that our future, our lives, our society, our business can be decided by people who just believe in some kind of magical ideas. It's absurd, and reject those companies. That's the only thing I would say.
You know, I want to, you did speak about faith a little bit earlier, but there has been research which shows that having some sort of faith in something helps you overcome obstacles, because as you said, people are in a world of uncertainty, are feeling helpless sometimes, and having faith in sometimes brings you up from where you are. Is there something wrong in having faith?
Yeah, for example, if you are on a tree and if you have faith that you can just jump down and nothing happens, it's very dangerous that if you jump. And if you are on the top of the building, you can have certainly faith, absolute faith, nothing happens. I mean, you have enormous confidence. And you can just jump from the 14th floor down. The confidence will take you down very easily, but that would be disastrous. But it's not faith that should decide. Many people, always we take decisions. And most of the time, faith without reason, faith without evaluation, faith without own judgment can get disastrous results. So faith can give you a lot of confidence. Yes, to jump from a 14th floor, it can give you confidence. But that's not realistic. That's not the proper way to do. And one should have one's own judgment, our senses, our common sense, our intelligence. That should guide us, not blind faith.
You know, you've been, for years, you've been sort of going around the country, busting people's myths that they're trying to create and sort of lure people into something that actually they're fraudsters. I want to ask you about this backlash that some people get when they're going against the norm. And why do you think people are so consumed by their religious ideologies that it turns so violent and aggressive?
When people are confronted with their faith, which they have been nursing for a long time as reality, sometimes they are shocked. In for example, if you are in a country like Saudi Arabia, if you do anything that the society considers wrong. For example, go around without a headgear, a female. You can be attacked by people. Earlier, they were not allowed to drive. And if you put your hand out, if you're driving as a female, people will come and hit your hand. Or if you fall in love before marriage, in many countries, you could be stoned to death. Why do people do it? Because they think that there are certain laws which we all have to be governed whether that's right or wrong, that's the correct thing for them. And they think that they should be the defendants of it. That's one set of people who think that the honor of their faith is to be protected. If anybody violates, they should be killed. People are sometimes doing, unacceptable things. Some people are killing their own children because they think that they have gone against their wishes, their tradition, their family's faith. Honor killings are very popular in South Asia. So why is it so? Because people are fanatic sometimes. And in some other situations, like for example, if somebody speaks against what they believed, either they think that this is not acceptable, they want to stop him immediately, they have a divine responsibility to stop it, and they will try to do it. If anybody speaks about a different faith, again that will happen. Anybody speaks against what they believed, well, there can be intolerance. In a society where there is more tolerance to others' views, other positions, other life views, other life stances, life standards, that's a society which is modern. In a society where people cannot tolerate any other opinion that they believe right, that's considered to be a conservative and a backward society. And luckily, in my view, India is not that backward a country. For example, I've been leading a major national campaign in 1994-95, covering around 1,000 villages in 100 districts. 18 months I've been on the road with my friends, traveling from Kanyakumari to Delhi. And we have gone into villages and villages, spontaneous meetings. We talk to people about their superstitions, how they should use scientific attitude to put up all these kind of things, how they should live without fear. Maybe I've been addressing several thousands of meetings, small groups of hundreds or 200s or 300 people. Not a single place I was attacked. Many people live in fear, live in the permanent fear of ghosts and gods and all this magical thinking, because they do not know the possibility to live without this fear. Once it's open, many people are happy. They are relieved because Indian faith system has a lot of doors which we can open. So there is a lot of possibilities. You can even reject any kind of faith and still have in the mainstream faith in India, because we have a lot of opening and possibilities in that. But on the other side, we can try to close it all. The more you close any kind of society, it becomes traditional, it goes backward. One of the old sayings, for example, from one of the ancient texts in Rigveda is, open the windows, open the doors, let light come from every side. It is from Rigveda. What better thing that a tradition can have more than that?
So at the beginning of the episode, I actually narrated the incident about you coming to Bombay and you investigating this statue and finding the water that came out through the hole and ran down the statue's feet. What happened after you found this?
I found it and very clearly, and I explained it on a very popular television program in the prime time the same evening. The church wanted their representatives to come in the program, and they shouted and screamed and make a lot of sound. But I could anyway explain it properly with charts and photographs and everything. But the bishop of Mumbai wanted this program to be stopped. So the television channel rather invited him to join in the discussion, and they refused to stop the program. And the bishop joined the discussion. So he anyway did not defend this miracle, but miracles he defended generally. We had a discussion on that, and the bishop was very furious because I knew perhaps better about the church's history of miracle mongering than him. And after the program, they got completely furious. The church sent some people in the van to attack me in the television studio to escape. And later they filed a lot of blasphemy cases. There have been discussions in their media that I should apologize to the archbishop of the church, or they will get me arrested in some case, or somewhere they will get me arrested, and then a co-prisoner will kill me and they will protect the killer. It was at that time I was traveling to Europe for a lecture tour, and I understood that what's happening, and I've been advised by close people in the government also what was happening. So I decided to stay out in Europe for some time till the dust settles down. Then I was planning to come to India after that. After some time, I was planning to come to India, and I was discussing with my colleague Narendra Dabholkar. And 4 days after my discussion with Narendra Dabholkar, making a plan to come to India, to go to Mumbai with a human wall protecting me when I go to a court, that's what we planned. Of course, the law itself is it's a baseless law, which was hundreds of years back, which was made before modern India was formed during the British time, that if anybody feels that his religious sentiments were hurt, and he could file a case against the person for which it's a cognitive and non-bailable, and I mean, he can be kept in prison, all these kind of things. I mean, this law should go. I mean, I thought I would get an opportunity to fight this law in the constitutional bench if they char the case. They didn't char the case. It was only filed against me. But I was more worried about the personal security. Well, my doubt and fear was true. After 4 days, Narendra Dabholkar was shot dead. Some months later, I hear Pansare was shot dead, then Kalburgi was shot dead, later Gauri Shilangesh. So I decided, well, I don't want to get into this kind of a situation. I would like to leave and continue what I do, because I have an important mission. I have an important job to fulfill, to complete. And I would like to educate people rather than get killed and become a martyr. I want to use this life to make it useful, to transform the society. And that's why I decided to stay abroad and continue my work in the same spirit.
Thank you, Sanal. I think this conversation for me has brought out a lot more questions, and I think that we all can sort of introspect a little bit and think more about our society and our culture and where we're living. Thank you for your time.
Thanks for listening to this mini episode. This podcast is created and hosted by me, Anmol Karnik, and is produced by Curious List, with music by Sanjeel Malik.